Hey everyone, I'm Truthman from OverClocking-TV, and today is the OC Show Season 2, Episode 9. Today I'm with some special guests. The first one is the regular one that we always have, the co-host of this show, Timothée. Hi Timothée, how are you?
Hey Truth, how's it going?
Doing well, doing well. The second special guest we have tonight is Dennis Garcia from Arrow Asylum, one of our regular guests here at the OC Show. Hi Dennis, how's it going on?
Hi Truth, thanks for having me back.
Always welcome, and always welcome. And the special guest for tonight, one of our longtime friends is Pepino, Christopher from MSI.
Hey Truth, how are you?
Doing good. So that's actually quite funny because Timothée and Christopher are straight from Taiwan right now. I'm in Montreal, and Dennis is from the boys on the other side of the America continent. So there's a lot of stuff to speak on tonight. And before we go on, we want to welcome all the new people to the show. Timothée, can you introduce a little bit more the concept of this show?
Oh yeah, sure. So the OC Show is a bi-monthly talk show about overclocking. We have a regular episode that we record with Peter, so Mathman from HIBOT here in Taipei. So basically we go over the news of the latest weeks, and then in this Q&A we do on Twitch, we basically go through the same topics again and add a lot more information to it, because we have a whole hour to discuss and we have the time to take questions from the audience. So usually that's the most fun part. And we also have some cool giveaways from time to time, such as today where we have some OCTV t-shirts to give away.
Do we have a special size for it?
No, any size. I think it goes from M, L, XL, and I think we even have some 2XL left as well, so should be no problem.
And in case someone need triple XL, we maybe can like do a special order for it.
Oh yeah, I'm sure we need to order some more anyway at some point, so it might take a little bit longer, but no problem at all.
So for the guest that we have tonight, Timothée, you are the co-host of this show. You were part of Overclocking TV, but you also work at HWBot for some times. So you have a lot of information in both the overclocking world, because that's actually your job now.
It's my job as well.
Right. And we have Dennis from Arrow Asylum. Can you present a little bit more to all the people that didn't know you from the previous show?
Yeah, sure. I'm Dennis Garcia. I'm editor-in-chief of HardwareAsylum.com. It's an enthusiast-level hardware review website. We deal with motherboards, video cards, cooling, overclocking, just about anything that goes into your computer and you can tweak. I also have a bi-weekly podcast talking about similar topics. The main show happens around the 10th. That's the one that we focus mostly on computer hardware and overclocking, and then there's an extra about halfway through where we talk about just whatever comes to our mind.
Great, thanks. And actually, the podcast is a nice way for me to cue to your podcast. It's bi-weekly. The OC Show is bi-weekly, and your podcast is directly, you can get it directly on iTunes, right?
Yes, it's on iTunes under Hardware Asylum. If you do a Hardware Asylum podcast, it will usually come up. Or you can go to hardwareasylum.com and there's a podcast link right at the top. You click on that and you can get the latest show and go back through the catalog.
Perfect. Actually, I want to remind you guys that the OC Show is also on SoundCloud for the audio part. So if you're hearing us on SoundCloud, just click the like button or repost, actually, to repost that to your SoundCloud timeline. Christopher, you're the senior technical... I lost it. What's your official title at MSI?
Senior technical or motherboard department.
Great. Actually, that's fun to have you on board, because you're French, like Timothée and me, and we used to do a lot of stuff like a few years ago in France all together, like doing some overclocking demonstration and so on. And like a few years after, you're living in Taiwan, you're working in one of the major manufacturers there. How was it, like, quickly for you to go from like the beginning of fun OC to this is my freaking job now?
It's just like an evolution. That's what I think most overclocker wants to achieve. And like, yeah, quite happy to be there and working in MSI. That's pretty cool. It's fun. Not every day, but it's fun. It's a lot of pressure. Like,
It's like a couple. It's not fun every day, but it's fun.
Yeah, it is. It is.
Well, thank you guys for being with us. It's highly appreciated that we can do this show. Let's go a little bit around the schedule for this tonight show. So first topic will be the HWBot World Tour Asia. Timothy, what's going on, especially at this one, very quickly?
HWBot is hosting an event. It's the third World Tour stop, and that's going to be like a big OC gathering. There will be some competitions with hardware to win and cash prizes.
Great, great. Second topic would be Computex 2015. We actually have Dennis that will probably go there. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in the next few minutes. And we have Pepino that is actually in Taiwan, so you of course going to be there. Then we're going to have a GPU Pi, the new GPU CPU benchmark. We're going to talk like about the history of this benchmark and why it's an important one and might come like a very important one in the near few months. We're going to also talk about the HWBot competition points, something that was like a flame war in the community, like should we reactivate them or not, how that's going to impact the ranking, what was done, what was activated and so on. Maybe we're going to talk a little bit about the world record points though. And the last part, and that's why we have Pepino here, the future of overclocking at MSI, what comes after MOA. There was a lot of discussion on Facebook Facebook status in different overclockers.
Especially
mine. I just point out because I don't have
you
all the insight.
You can point out to yourself, it's fine.
I was just like, oh, okay, maybe there's something going on, maybe nope, but officially I don't know anything, so this is, I think Pepino will have a lot of information for us tonight. So that's pretty much for the schedule for tonight. I would like to thanks all the people right here on the chat. I want to thanks Daniel313131, DM Quake Live, Gniadol from Brazil, hey man, sorry you can come to Computex, I heard that a few days ago that you won't make it. And welcome to Julius, our friend from Czech Republic. So thank you guys for being here, and also Herbuas from Brazil. Seems like there's a lot of Brazilian tonight that's speaking Portuguese in the live chat.
Yeah. Cool.
Todo bem, Brazil. Okay, guys, first topic, Tim.
Yep, HWBot World Tour. So that event is going to take place here in Taipei. It's going to be the third World Tour stop. And before we announce actually this, we should turn on the raffle because there's going to be some information very quick. So you can win an OCTV t-shirt. And to that, you have to answer to the following questions is, what are the dates of this HWBot World Tour? So if you are looking for it, check on the HWBot front page. And other places, there's some news a bit everywhere, as well as on OCN, for example, and other forums, even hardware.info. So if you guys are looking when the event is, just type in exclamation mark raffle and the date. You need the month and the 3 days of the event. So you need the three exact numbers of the days. And so that event is going to take place in Taipei right after Computex, wink, wink. It's going to be a big gathering, so every year there's about 20 to 30 overclockers that come to Taipei for taking part in the show, either being on a demonstration on a booth or being there just as a tourist or competing in diverse and competitions. There will be, for example, the G-Skill World Cup finals during this year. And so on the occasion of all those people coming to Taipei, there's no better place to actually do a gathering where everyone can come and sit together in one room, have fun benching whatever they want. And thanks to some sponsors that are Asus, Intel, HyperX, and Seasonic, as well as Dematec for the bench table, there will be some cool prizes to win for the guys that will compete, as well as a little bit of cash, so which is always a nice way to pay back your plane ticket if you haven't had the chance to win it in a competition. So that's it.
The raffle is open, so if you guys want to win the t-shirt for the some information that might happen tonight, who knows, that you can find online, you can just go on the live chat and type exclamation mark raffle and the 3 dates of the HWBot World Tour Asia. Thanks, Timothy, for all the details. Actually, that would be interesting to have all these informations going on, but there's actually a little bit more that we can expect from the World Tour right now.
Yeah, there's a little bit more because there's going to be three activities, right? So, like I said, there's the gathering, and the two other activities, which are the big two other activities, are the ROG OC Showdown. So that's that will be hosted in some on an area on the same venue, and would be a dedicated ROG area where the guys will be able to compete for 13 targeted scores. So basically, there's a bit of everything. There's some hardware first places. There's some global first place and some world records, and all different have different, I would say, cash bounties. And so, who gets holds the record at the end of the competition, which is ending at 6 p.m. on Sunday, so Sunday the 7th. And so, who holds the record wins the cash. It's as simple as that. There's some hardware provided to help the guys. Because of course you cannot carry all your stuff to Computex, and so people will be able to hopefully get some interesting scores, but most of all have a lot of fun facing each other, and that's what we are going to be interested into for the stream, right, Truffman?
Yeah, actually the live stream will be up all weekend long, so that's going to be like Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, right after Computex. The live will be all long, and actually the different thing, because remember last year we did the live for 3 days during the OC gathering. This year we're gonna have some special guests. I still need to talk with Albrecht to make sure that he can be there for most of the special show. Don't worry guys, you know that happened in Taiwan, so it's very difficult for the time zone, but we're gonna have special show for everyone. If you're in Europe, you're gonna have a special show for it. If you're in the US, you're gonna have a special show for it. If you live in Asia, you're gonna have a special show for it. Although, so don't worry, every time you're everywhere you are in the world, you can actually follow what's going on. We're gonna have some special feedback from the screen of the guys competing at the ROG Showdown area. And yeah, to be honest, I can't wait. I can't wait for it. Yeah. That's gonna be fun. That's gonna be a long live, I guess.
Yeah. So the stream is the whole day, is the whole time, right? So June 6, 7, and 8, right? Which are the dates of the event, right?
So yeah, actually we're going to start, we're going to start 10 a.m. Taipei time, but that's going to be Friday evening for all the guys in America. Like Brazil, that's going to be Friday evening. USA, Canada, that's going to be Friday evening for you guys. So you can start tuning from Friday up until Sunday evening. For everyone else, that's going to be Saturday to Monday.
Yep, cool.
That's going to be fun. That's going to be fun. Dennis, do you actually plan to stop by the event because you're going to Computex?
Yes, I ordered my ticket online using the whatever the ticket ordering thing was. And I do plan to be there at least for one full day reporting. And I might help a couple of people with some video card overclocking. But I'm not going to bring any gear, so... maybe I'll borrow some. Maybe I'll have to pay for the upgraded ticket and get a seat.
That's pretty cool.
Pepino, you're in Taiwan. Do you plan to stop by the HWBOT World Tour Asia?
Probably on the first day, yeah. I will say hi to everyone.
Because actually we are like, that's a community thing, so most of us know each other for a long time, so that's actually a good way to meet everyone at the same place. And have a talk in the chat.
Yeah.
Talk in the chat. Yeah, it's like, like a talk is more like discussing rumors, and the chat is more like, hey, do you want a beer or a coke?
So beer or coke? That's the new question, guys. What do you prefer?
Beer or coke?
Yeah. Yeah. Dennis is gonna show a Pepsi can for sure. Yeah, I win. Okay, so what was the question already to win the t-shirt?
So to win the t-shirt, you have to answer when is the event? So what are the dates of the event? You need to give us the month as well as the dates. What the day's numbers exactly, to be precise. So you don't need to say what day of the week, that doesn't matter. So it takes place on three different days right after Computex, so you guys can figure it out. So t-shirt to win. If you guys have any questions about the World Tour, just ask, and we'll just get back to that very shortly. And that's it. Chof, you switched to that weird angle. I'm not too sure what you're doing.
Actually,
lost in your pages?
Yeah, I'm lost in pages because it should move, but it's not moving at all. So not yeah, I will switch back to the regular one. I will let you talk to the next topic and
sure.
I will switch to the next one.
All right. So next topic is Computex 2015, and that's probably the most epic moment of the year, I think. I think for most guys, that's that means a lot of party, but that means also as well sometimes some crazy new stuff being launched or interesting things. I'm not too sure what's going to be happening this year. Well, I would be there for sure because I'm living here in Taipei. So, but I haven't much planned yet. You know, besides the world tour, I would just be walking around and holding my camera, see what's going on, if there's something interesting. There's some rumors about some GPUs, you know, on both sides of the line, and there's some rumors about some upcoming new stuff, but I'm not too sure what we are going to see yet at the venue. Actually, Pepino, what do you have planned with the two guys that won the MSI competition that will be here for Computex?
Actually, we will have them bench on the Worldwalker stage on the G-Skill competition, the G-Skill event, the OC event. They will participate on the MSI day, so we will try to achieve some world record on the G-Skill stage with also bench pros. And I think from G-Skill side, there will be Stepons and Young Pro if he can attend the event. So yeah, those guys try to help us to reach some world record on our X99 boards. And yeah, we already have some nice plan for the world record stage.
You have some stuff in the pipe that might be very interesting and stick around the booth?
Yeah, probably. I don't know.
You don't know, right? Yeah, right.
Well, it's true. The World Cup is a pretty tough competition because so the way it works is like vendors are not exactly facing each other, but the guys that are representing the which are competing in the competition always represent a vendor anyways, so they pick a motherboard. So in the end, they end up being like an MSI team or being a Gigabyte team or being an Asus team. So in the end, it's very important for you guys, I guess, to win that competition.
Yeah, to make... Actually, there is no winner, but like achieve some model core will be like great. Yeah, sure. On stage, you know, it's always a lot of pressure. You have less preparation. There is always people trying to talk to you to say, hey, what are you doing? And so on. So it's always like very hard to achieve world record on stage. So yeah, it's rigorous. Usually you need some preparation, some good hardware and so on. So it's always a challenge. So I think it will be nice for the guys.
Yeah. So in terms of preparation, you fly them in before the event to prepare at HQ or they just arrive already?
Yeah. They will have some preparation in HQ and in G-Skill HQ too. So yeah, we will have some days before to prepare the stage. And on MSI book this year, we don't have any OC event going because like logistically was not feasible. Like there is not much space on the book because we also have also many other stuff to show. And motherboard is not the only department on the Computex booth. So it was not possible to make a stage for overclocking this year. And anyway, wouldn't make much sense. So yeah, we will keep, we will have more plans in the next months. But yeah, for Computex, basically, our main plan is to go to the G-Skill event. And we will have that go-kart after party that with HW that I just put online a few minutes ago.
Yeah. I can't wait for it.
So that would be on the 9th, right after the event?
Yeah, just right after the HWBot event. Like we were going to take the guys to Taoyuan and have some go-kart here. We rent a track for 3 hours and we will organize a small championship with a motherboard to win. And then we will take them out for some beer and some dinner.
Yeah, that's always nice. Cool. Finally, some competition that is not about computers. Yeah.
Yeah, if it's the same track,
I guess
Trufman,
you were planning on winning, right?
Yeah. I do have a long story with. Beating some overclockers, some top overclockers at go karting, back from some long time ago. But I will take my revenge one day.
I know the track very well, so I can tell them to just give you the slowest go-kart. That's no problem.
Well, actually, I do expect that to be the same track we went last year after the Was it last year after MOA? Yeah, last year after MOA.
MOA, yeah.
That was fun. The same track.
Well,
yeah.
the first card you choose, you're dismissed to take one. So be careful. Because I know which ones go faster than the others.
Actually, I can tell right away it's the number two.
So that's going to be a fight to get that one.
The number two. It's the fastest one, but it's also the hardest to unveil because the chassis is like torn. So.
Well, I can see that you've been to that track quite a few times already.
Yeah, actually, yeah. I had nothing to do for some months, so I would go there every day, and like it was fully empty, and the guy would show me the lines and so on. So it was pretty fun track.
Yeah. So the overclockers, Pepino, the overclockers coming for MSI, that would be Vivi and Wizardy, right?
Right, okay. Vivi and Witherty. Yeah, so they won the MOA Extreme Series online competition, and they won their ticket for the Computex. So we will have them in our HQ to prepare the JSK World Record stage. Also, they may try to attend to achieve some world record in HQ anyway. So we will see what's the afterwards of the events.
Yeah. All right, and so as other competition, there's also other guys that won a ticket that's in the Gigabyte competition, and that was Coldest from Indonesia, who won the Gigabyte Big XTU challenge. So that was a huge competition where you had basically to hit an insane amount of targets, and I think Coldest did very good at being very dedicated at it, so he's going to be... From what I understood, benching on the Gigabyte booth, and after that, I'm not too sure. He will probably swing by the HDevOut World Tour event. Dennis, what's your plan for Computex besides hoping for seeing unreleased stuff?
Well, being that I run a hardware review website, everybody in Computex is pretty much the people that we focus on in terms of hardware. Just in general. So obviously I'm hoping to see something new. In the past couple of years, there's been kind of very lackluster in terms of product releases. They always come out like 3 days before the show and never really much to see on the show floor. But I'm looking forward to the OC stage. Galax usually has some sort of overclocking that happens.
Oh yeah, right. Yep. True.
And then MSI always had like one little small corner that was dedicated to overclocking, and nobody was ever there. So I'm not surprised that they're not having that this year. ASUS always has like a gaming thing, so I always like to go and check that out.
The ROG press conference thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then I haven't received any invitation yet, so I'm not sure if they are having it. We'll see.
Yeah, they might not. And
maybe it would be just ASUS event.
Yeah, could be. And then Gigabyte always has some sort of event, either like sit down and play games on their machine, or watch somebody overclock and get liquid nitrogen sprayed on you or whatever. But they have that at Taipei 101s, and that's always
true. Fun to check out. Yeah, they have a nice view from up top up there, like 35th floor or something.
Yeah, I think it's 36 or 38 something.
Yeah, it's in the 30s. It's up there. So there's always something to see at Computex. I've been there, this would be like my 11th or 12th time going. So, I'm a bit seasoned in what to see and who to go see and what order to see them in. So I'm going to try to pack as much in as possibly can this year.
Yeah. So I'm going actually quickly back to the MSI topic, because there were some discussions online as well as why XA, which ranked second in that competition, is not going instead of the two other guys that are top one and top three in the competition. And I guess, Truthman, you wanted to add something to that.
Yeah, I don't know the official answer officially yet. Wizard T finished first, then XA finished second, and GV finished third of the online competitions. So if you look online on the OCEsport website, you can check, and the it's closed. That's how it was at the closing. But the two official people that were declared winner, if I can say, were Wizardy and Vivi. Pepino, can you just explain us why it's like this? Were there some cheating issues, or were there some any kind of issue that we can that you can talk about tonight?
Yeah, the reason is simple, is because XA has been banned last year from MOA. So actually, we let him compete in the that online event because the return of competition points like was not so fair to take away the points for him from him. So we let him compete for only for the competition points. But yeah, he was banned from the event last year for 1 year actually. So he cannot compete or be supported by MSI for 1 year.
So he cannot compete until mid-October next year then, this year.
Yeah, it's no cheating issue or something. We all know XA, and yeah, this time, like, yeah, he's
yeah. XA. It's just the ban is still going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So actually, I'm sad for XA, but I'm great that at least someone from the manufacturing side took the lead, and thanks MSI for that, to make sure that these are competitions you cannot fuck up, otherwise they're gonna be some payback at some point.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. For people that know XA, we know why. So congratulations, Wizardy and VV. So XA gonna still get the points on the rankings, but is not invited by MSI directly. Well,
yeah, he couldn't get any prize anyway. So his ban is like he cannot get support or get any prize and so on. He cannot enter MSI competition either. But in that particular case, since we discussed with HWBot, and since yeah, the competition points were going back. And he will, like, he already posted some score, you know, he's XA, so he already entered.
He will always bench anyway.
Yeah. No matter if it was banned or not, so I think it was fair to give him his points, his competition points, but yeah, anyway, we cannot reward him with anything, so that's the thing. But yeah, next year, I think, like, his ban will end in November, so we don't have any problem to work with him, like, further. We can go work with him. Already I'm talking to him regularly, and there is no problem. We can go work again.
Yeah. So I have one more question about Computex, guys. What do you expect in terms of unreleased hardware? For those of you that haven't signed any yet, of course.
Okay, I didn't sign anything, so I do expect a new GPU going out.
Okay.
I can't say it from which sides because I don't know when NVIDIA gonna launch something, when AMD gonna launch something. I don't know if it's before Computex, right after. Well, that's gonna be like during June, pretty much, I guess, because that makes sense. If they want to launch in June, they can release. They do the paper launch in June. They can actually add the stock in September for the back to school. That's actually business wise, that makes more sense. I do expect some new CPU from Intel. I don't know exactly if we will have anything for that, or that's going to be behind closed door, because there may be a same thing like release that just for the back to school or just before the Xmas time. Once again,
so that's in link with the Skylake leak we saw, right?
Yep. There was some people.
I saw some CPU-Z stuff.
We saw some CPU-Z on some of our Facebook friends showing up. What's going on with the SuperPi score? What's going on with the frequency we can reach for it? Well, let's say so far that's only rumors. So
that's something I can tell. It won't be released at Computex.
Yeah. That's what I hear too about the CPUs. About the GPUs, I think we'll probably see some, but I'm not sure we can use them actually properly at the event. I don't know.
I'm working for more department.
you don't know.
So my hands are not tied, but I don't know.
You didn't cite any idea then.
Well, you have the MSI NDA, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, Dennis, what do you expect from the show?
Well, that's kind of interesting because the next podcast episode that'll be coming out in a couple of weeks, we kind of talked about Computex a little bit and how for the past like 4 or 5 years, you know, I always make a prediction saying, oh yeah, there should be a new CPU, there should be a new GPU, there should definitely be a new motherboard. And then when you get to the show, it's not there. So I'm hoping that there's going to be a new GPU, maybe one with some letters at the end or something, who knows. But that probably won't be until after. I'm hoping for an X99 refresh. It's been a year since that board's been out, so we're we usually see a refresh around halfway through, usually for like the super high-end boards. You know, the high-end overclocking board and high-end gaming board, there's usually some sort of a refresh to, you know, give it a new, new Ethernet controller or new soundboard or something like that, right?
And then obviously, controller?
We're already for MSI, it's already done on the X99 side, so.
Yeah. And then, you know, there's always going to be, like, chassis stuff and new expansion cards to increase, you know, something. Something to do something at some place, somewhere.
New iPhone case?
And this isn't really related to overclocking so much, but now that the USB 3.1 controllers are starting to get integrated on the motherboards, we will start seeing a lot of devices that will take advantage of that, mostly for like storage and like video rendering and stuff. So maybe those will be, you know, some small corner of a booth somewhere.
Yeah, usually you have those booths of those manufacturers that have all the accessories and all that kind of stuff that always have some crazy things. So that's usually, I think, for me, that's the most interesting part of Computex as well. Walking around all those small booths of not the big brands, you know, but the manufacturer probably for everyone else, you know. And then you just see they have all those crazy gadgets or prototypes of things that are unreleased or that are just like in the works that could exploit different technologies. And usually yeah, they have some pretty cool stuff there.
Yeah, I mean, and that also brings up a good point that, you know, the cycle of things. You have CES, which is pretty much everything we saw during Christmas. And then we have CeBIT, which is typically it was like vaporware. So it was all the super pre-release stuff that, you know, wasn't going to get manufactured, but they want to show it anyway. And then you have Computex, which is the solidification of everything that's gone through the design process. Now it's being manufactured. So that will be what we can see at Christmas time and back to school. So
yep.
That's usually that's right. The genesis of hardware.
I can't wait for it. Actually, I can't wait for Computex. I don't have plan to be to do anything special except the world tour. I'm focusing mostly on that. I think I will just go around with you, Timothée, and the camera, just check all the OC booth, just to...
Yeah.
Well, that's the best time of the year to see everyone at the same place. It's very difficult to see everyone and to have a good talk with everyone, but it's always good to actually see so many people in such a short time and to actually like, hey, yeah, it's been a year. How was it for the past year and so on? So, well, lot of networking, to be honest. Yeah.
You only come for the parties. Stop lying.
Yes, only for the parties. At 60%,
okay.
At least.
Okay. 51% maybe.
And the food.
Yeah. Okay. Like, the food. That's true. Well, it's always fun for anyone that that went to Taiwan at least once in his life will understand the food concept. I just can't wait to have some deep fried stuff and some barbecuing. And, well, can't wait to be back there. And that's gonna be in 2 weeks.
All right, let's move on before we open a culinary show and start discussing food.
And all the special Taiwanese beers. And, well, anyway, we're going to talk about that during the HWBOT World Tour broadcast, maybe.
Yeah, would you remind the dates, Truth? I haven't heard the
yeah, date. That's Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, June 7th. 7, 8, and 9.
You're just bad at dates. Yeah, oh, June 6, 7,
yeah,
8.
So that June 6, June 7, and June 8. Yeah, that's it. That's Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. I just always get confused because for everyone living in America, Brazil, Canada, USA, that's going to be on Friday evening for you guys.
Yeah.
Well... Don't forget that if you want to win a t-shirt, you can just type !raffle and the 3 dates of the HWBOT World Tour Asia. That was just a big hint. I would like to thank all the guys on the live chat. I know there's a lot of Brazilian right now. I would like to thank Fools18, Cheers Cherish, Avos Jogos, Erilton, Erivelton75, Rainy, Pitchaker, Giuliano, Misfire, Carlos Eduardo, Drag Gravos, and all the other guys that did follow us in the last few minutes. So thank you guys. Next topic, GPU Pi.
Yeah, GPU Pi, and that's a pretty cool benchmark, Truffman. It's developed by the guys from Overclockers.at, especially Matthias, which we had once on the show. For him, that show was quite painful because it was super early in the morning. And so I asked him again if he wanted to be part of this show. And he said, yeah, man, like last time was so hardcore. The next day I didn't do anything, you know. So, which I totally understand, you know. So, yeah. So we haven't him on the show this time, but we'll try to make a video with interview with him to know a little bit more. But GPU Pi, so that's a CPU / GPU benchmarks. It's using CUDA and OpenCL, how do you call it, frameworks or libraries to calculate Pi on the different pieces. And the point is very similar actually to SuperPi in some way, which where you, instead of doing 1M and 32M here, we are like the 100M and 1B, right? But it works the same way. So you have the loops and you can track the times for each loop. And of course, the goal is always the same, be the fastest. So that's a cool benchmark, and I really like how it integrates with HDoiBot, which is beyond what is already done with XTU. So XTU, you know, you can tweak your system, and then you benchmark it, and you upload it there with a button to HDoiBot. While here, it also takes the screenshot and everything. The only thing it doesn't do yet is open in CPU-Z for you, so you can still forget to open some tabs. But I mean, besides that, it uploads the screenshot, everything to HDoiBot, so it's pretty convenient, actually. I don't know, Truff, have you tried it already?
I have to be honest, I downloaded it. I haven't got time to try it, and that's a very bad of me to didn't try it yet. But I will try maybe sooner or later. Actually, it's a non-working day tomorrow here in Canada, so I might give it a try tomorrow morning then.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there you go.
it's actually easy to run and it's fast, so you don't have to install like five prerequisites. You don't have to like install .NET. You don't have to go around with the setting and so on. You just select bench and that's it. So yeah, that's gonna be very easily.
Yeah.
So
Dennis, did you try it? Yep.
I haven't tried it yet. No, but I do have a couple of questions about it that are kind of related. So the CPU, or the CPU version, SuperPi, it's only single-threaded, so it only uses one core. Is the GPU Pi a multi-core? Will it use all the cores in the GPU, or is it mostly one-core memory interaction sort of overclocking?
So from what I understood, it should be multi-everything.
Okay. And that supports the whole CUDA aspect of it if it's running.
Yeah, so you can have multiple GPUs with all your GPU cores. So, of course, the record for that kind of thing will probably be a cluster servers of EGAs, I suppose.
No, yeah, possibly. Well, and the interesting thing that I would like to see is if you run more than one card. So, like, if you run two GPUs, if it's going to use all the cores across there. Because in the past, like, I've run similar benchmarks through Cysoft Sandra. And you can't enable SLI or Crossfire if you want to use all the cores. So that might be a tip for people that are trying to run this benchmark. I like the concept of the benchmark, though. This is something that was missing from the hardware bot repertoire, if you will. Just a standard raw calculation benchmark instead of one that was dictated by screen resolution. And if you happen to have what is it, the level of detail on or off and stuff like that.
True, yeah. Especially for people that do rendering, usually level of details doesn't really matter anyway. You're not counting frames per second. So if it's just pure raw calculation, for instance, also people that used to do Bitcoin or things like this, right? Like that's where the GPU power actually matters with the frameworks and stuff.
Yeah, well, and also, as you guys probably know, running Adobe Premiere, we'll use the GPU power instead of CPU power to render video. So,
yeah, most of the editing software, even Photoshop, right, uses the GPU cores for most of the rendering. So, there's not so much going on the CPU nowadays. It seems.
No, not
or
so
less
much.
And less.
what you can see on the screen is the evolution of the world record. So that's the best score ever achieved with this benchmark. We can see that it was like almost like 20, actually it was 21 seconds in November when it was first used, and then it's now like 2 seconds.
Yeah, it's already really, really low. I don't know if Matthias expected it to go so fast. That graph is actually pretty cool. Even if you, that's the 1B graph, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you look at the 100M, it's also very interesting as well. It's like like those graphs, they just completely dropped at some point. I think it relates before you had the beta one, so not so many people used it, but as soon as points were activated on the benchmark, it was the gold rush. I don't know for you, Pepino, if you benched it a little bit or not, but...
No, I don't bench that much anymore. Besides Pro CCAP, I don't do much benching. Mm. Besides, like, I have a test platform there and testing a lot of stuff, but not benching. But yeah, I saw some epic battles between, like, Dancop and Strategos Sam. So when you get the top overclockers involved and have fun with it, I think it's, like, a good benchmark anyway.
Yeah, usually if the benchmark is good, people bench it.
It's not like I'm not the one which can tell like this benchmark is good or not. I think it's the community who can say like we like it or we don't like it. That or that to improve. So I think the when I saw like that some guys had fun with it and start to play with it, it's definitely a new good benchmark.
Yeah. I really like the loop thing. Like when you can follow each loop. Like, you don't waste time on your benchmark. If it's bad, you just quit, and there's no point of wasting 6 minutes or whatever, or 3 minutes, and still that little moment in the benchmark where you know you fucked up.
The biggest drop was in GPU Pi for CPU, the 1B.
Yes.
Because at the beginning, someone just tested like on the very slow Athlon. It was like 49 minutes, and then the next goal was like... 13 minutes. It was like a huge drop at the beginning, and then you can see that when it's actually that's true when it gets the points, people start benching it and start reaching for the scores. It's all around April that the first drop happened. It was consistent.
Yeah,
and then
as
huge drop.
It.
Yeah, as soon as you have the points for it, there's people using it and benching for it.
Yeah. Whoa. What do you guys think of the screenshot thing that it? Well, you need to have internet, I guess, which most overclockers don't use on the machine. But I guess to upload the score directly to HWBOT, do you guys think that's a cool thing that other benchmarks should have eventually at some point, or it's not really necessary? You guys prefer paint, screenshot button?
I like the one shot.
The making your own screenshot is, that's the classic way of doing it, but it was always open to manipulation, so to speak. You know, not necessarily cutting your entire screen, but just a small section of the screen. And I would rather see the whole thing. And then that way you get kind of the date and time of when it happened and stuff like that. But when Unigen Heaven went with the hardware bot wrapper for their benchmark, that was something that I really liked. And I would really like to see more of the benchmarks follow that same pattern.
Yeah, some kind of official recognized watermark on the screen that just proves it.
to make it easier for new people coming into it to make sure that everything's on the screen and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Then, you know, there's always going to be a file that comes along with it. So whatever information is entered will be validated to make sure that it matches, stuff like that.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, there's just missing, like I said, a CPU Z thing that opens the tab. That might come one day, hopefully. Actually, what is necessary, I think, is a CPU Z version for overclockers, which just opens all the four tabs at once. I mean, like, seriously, guys, why are we opening four times CPU Z?
Oh, you just launched the shortcut and just open all the tabs and plus them on the
yeah. I mean, like this, you would not forget any, right, to begin with. That might be something to tell to the CPU Z guys, CPU ID guys.
Pepino, do you like the way you can take the screenshot directly in it, or what do you expect to be like more integrated to it?
I told you I didn't try yet.
Yeah, but you know the concept. What was the biggest time you lose when you bench, like opening all the stuff for the screenshots? Because even when you bench 3DMark, like you bench 3DMark at the office sometimes, and well, you can just save and go online. But if you want to submit, you need to have like the CPU-Z, the GPU-Z, and all the information for it.
Yeah, it's not that big of an issue. It's just like when you're on the edge of your setup is like not so stable, it can be an issue, but like when your setup is pretty consistent, it's not that big of an issue to have to open this for me.
Well, I remember in 2007 when we were benching at iProfive's lab in Greece, and it was like taking ages. It was taking like maybe 10 minutes after the score was up just to take the screenshot. Oh yeah, I just want to change that. I just want to change this. And just is taking the screenshot like 10 minutes after it's done. So it's 10 minutes that the system is like almost stable. You can crash at any time. So
That was back in the days, I guess.
Yeah, that was fun. That was fun.
Yeah.
Tim?
Yes?
How can we win the t-shirts?
Okay, so we've got a OCTV t-shirt to win, guys. If you haven't paid any attention, I'm going to not tell you the answer, but I can tell you, you can find the answer on the HDiveBot front page. So you just go hdivebot.org. And the question is, when is the HDiveBot World Tour Asia going to take place? It's taking place in June, but you need to tell us June what date numbers. So it's going to be taking place just after Computex. Hit the exclamation mark, raffle, and type in the dates. And you might win a t-shirt, so good luck with that.
I would like to thank a lot of the guys that do follow us, and one that have a funny name, What's Up? So yeah, that was it.
Right, truth, move on.
Next topic is HDiveBot competition points. So, Dennis, you were here with us, I think that was two episodes ago when we announced that the competition points would be removed. There were some issue like calculating them with the ocesport.io website and hdiveBot.org because it's the same database in the backend. There was some issue for that, and they're coming back but changing the name. It's not competition points anymore, it's called esports points. So what's going on with that, Timothée?
So what's going on with that? Basically, so the points were removed, and now they will be added back. They will be slightly different. Before, they used to stay forever, so that's gone. Now the points are going to last for a year. It's going to be called esports points. It's going to be added to your HDiveBot total points, basically. And they're going to stay there from 1 year from the date onwards to the last year. So if you had a competition last year where you won some points until today, well, those points are valid until today, and tomorrow they will be gone from your ranking. Of course, you will keep them on the OC Sports 2014 league, like a ranking, the Overclockers ranking, but you're going to lose them on the HDiveBot profile because they don't stay forever. What is important also for this is that some benchmarks seem to have more points than others, because the fact is that usually the amount of points you get is based on the popularity of the hardware. So the most popular it is, the most points you get. So that's the second change that has been done, where the world records now get extra points. So before, you could run a four-way system and get the top score or like the record for it. And you would not get as much points as someone that would hold a global first place, for example, in a single, I don't know, GTX 780 Ti, for instance, because that hardware in a single card was more popular. So now, if you hold the records, you get 100 points extra. So which brings you back to the about the same level as the guy that holds the global first place for the single card. So in that case, makes thing a little bit more fair in terms of difficulty, but because of course getting the world record is usually slightly harder than getting just a single card global first place. And some scores were for all the benchmarks that didn't scale that much with new GPUs and that are now very CPU bounded. Well, all those scores, usually you could get the record with just two graphics cards, for instance. You have, for example, you had Aquamark, 3Marco 3, 3Marco 5, 3Marco 6. So those benchmarks, they will not get those 100 points for the record to make sure that the things stay kind of in tune. If not, you end up with you ended up with records with 250 points or something, which was not making any sense. So yeah, that's the main changes. So it's not affecting that much the rankings from what I saw, just a few here and there changes, but it's going to be interesting to see how things evolve in the near future.
That. So if we sum up, see if we sum up what's going on. So we have the competition points that are coming back. They are called esports points, and they are just lasting for 1 year. That would be actually funny to see around Computex. There's a lot of competitions going on, so some people might drop just before Computex and get them right after, stuff like this. There's the world record point downgrade, so Aquamark, 3DMark 01, 3DMark 05, and 3DMark 06 don't get the extra 100 points that they deserve before. Otherwise, you go well over the 150 maximum point you can get.
And yeah, so those are only those two legacy benchmarks. Huh? All the others get the points.
Yeah, sure. So that's the very old one that are just CPU bound pretty much lately. Yeah. That used to be graphic benchmark, but it's not true anymore.
Yeah, they're not really 3D anymore.
Well, some people say they're not really benchmark anymore. I don't agree with that, but that's still benchmark, just different kind.
So, Dennis, you hold a few competition points of your own.
I have two or three of them, I think.
So, what do you think about this change? Do you think it's a good thing that the points don't stay forever in the rankings and the world record points that are added to the guys that hold the world records?
You know, at first, I was a little concerned at first, partially because my competition points, I don't have a lot of them, so it counts toward my actual ranking points on Hardware Bot. So, but I do like the fact that they kind of go away, because what that does is that gives people watching the rankings an idea of how active the overclocker is in the competition. So if you have, like, Splayed, for instance, is really active in 2014, he's going to have a lot of points if he ranks well. Now, in 2015, if he didn't enter that many competitions, but then we have Wizardy, for instance, that started doing a lot, then that ranking is going to change, and it's going to reflect how active they are in the community. From that standpoint, it's actually a good thing. For me, where I only have a few points here or there from the five or six that I've entered, once they go away after a year, then my ranking, my global ranking, is going to drop considerably just because of that. If I never did any benching at all, then, you know, I'm going to lose points just because of the fact that they drop off.
So that's a sad news, I guess, a little bit, but
you know, for me, it's not that bad, because I would expect to be rewarded for participating. And if I'm going to lose points because I didn't participate, then, you know, that's the cost of entry.
Yeah, I guess. Well, especially nowadays, there's a lot of competitions as well. It's pretty pretty active. Well, the last year was really, really active. So for the guys that even participated in all of them without winning necessarily anything, but just ranking enough to get a few points, that some valuable points you can at least keep for the year just by being active, right? What do you think about that, Pepino?
I think the competition points is like a good idea, because I think it's fair to reward the guy which compete in the online and live competition, because like I said before, you have less preparation time, you have like more pressure, it's usually more difficult to achieve something in live events. So yeah, I think it was fair to reward those guys like Splave, like Witherty, like Ixe, and so on, because they spend a lot of time to get in those competitions, to score in those competitions, and it needs to be rewarded. And the rules for 1 year, I think it's like just logical, like you don't get your points forever. Like it will not be fair for other guys, and not be logical neither. So the one year rule is fair, is pretty nice, because after 1 year, like if the guy, like Dennis said, if the guy don't compete anymore in live events, it gives a chance to other to get back in the ranking. That's good.
Yeah, I think also what is going to be interesting is for the new guys, the totally new guys, like the rookies, to participate in Rookie Rumbles or the Novice Nimbus or some very early stage competitions, they will very quickly go up the ranking. So it might be a good motivation, you know, to like, I'm really active and I actually did two Rookie Rumbles and I'm in the top 10 of the rookies already, you know. So it's pretty encouraging to start and not being like You look at the number, oh yeah, rank 25,000. I have 0.2 points per submission, what the fuck?
Actually, the same for top overclockers, because if they want to stay in the ranking, they will need to compete in the live or online competition to get more points. Yeah. So that's also, yeah, I think overall it's improving.
Yeah, true.
It's an improvement.
Yeah, I like it like this.
I think it's a good incentive for everyone to always stay there, not just show off and disappear, and then come back, show off, and disappear, stuff like this, to be like more regular score submitter, I would say.
Yeah, we used to see those guys that were usually coming, like loading a lot of points, and then just stopping for a little bit, and being pretty much number one without doing anything for 6 months or something like that. So for sure, now it's going to be a little bit different. Truth, you have any competition points?
I don't think I have. Let me check. I don't think I have any. And if I have some, it's like well over 1 year ago. So I don't think I have any. You know what? Let's check right away. That's
you didn't cool. even participate in the old school, is best school one?
No, because the board is still on the shelf. Actually, I do have two competition points. let me check from where.
But I'm probably not into your ranking now anyway.
Intel XTU Overclocking Challenge Level 1 and Challenger Division 7 Round 2 Level 1. Ranked 49.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah,
so actually, so I do have
you
one
posted
point
a score with your phone.
Yeah, that's at default. So yeah, I have one competition point this year. Yeah!
Actually, I think if you do, last year there was how many? I think there was almost 80 competition that they show you about. So if you do all of them, just submitting one score, you know, you get at least 80 points. Which is not bad, you know. It's like it's pretty all right.
But you still have to play. You have to be able to, you have to rank. Yes. You can't just submit a score.
Well, some competitions, sometimes you get 1 point just to be in there. Depends which one.
Yeah. You have 66 eSport points. Pepino?
Yeah, just check with together with Thomas, because you know we use the Overclocking Knights user profile.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Together with Thomas, but actually we enter a competition together. So, actually, I just checked and we have 66. Our ranking improved. That's it.
Yeah, that's it. There you go. Well, I guess that's always the thing with ranking changes. It always profits one or the other, you know. So the guys that didn't profit is going to either, you know, bitch a little bit about it or not, and then the other guys are like, yeah, that's the best change in the world.
Yeah, last year we attempted some competition during Computex. I think you remember the Intel challenge and so on.
The Intel
Kingston. Yeah, Intel OC challenge and also the Kingston HOT, yeah. I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. I think that the competition point is a good thing, and the 1 year limit is not an issue. That would keep people say.
It's good, you know. It's like every sport; you always measure on the season. You don't measure like, oh yeah, this guy he won the Olympics 5 years ago, so he's still the champion, you know. But no, not anymore. He probably can't run anymore anyway. I don't know. Yeah. So yeah.
Well, next topic. Last one?
Go ahead.
It's last one, and actually I like this one. So,
well,
that's going to be quick because we're like 57 minutes already in the show, so we're going to maybe spend like 10-15 minutes on that. But overclocking at MSI, what is after MOA? For the people that don't know what happens, MSI, so that was the MSI, I have the website right here. Extreme Master Series that was going on the... on HWBot and actually OCEsport.io, and at the end I saw a press release saying, oh yeah, we just announced the new winner for the MSI MOA 2015, and it's like, hey, was that the official MOA or was that just the competitions? So actually we have Pepino right here with us from MSI that can tell a little bit more about that. So I would have a few questions for you. Was that the real MSI for 2015?
Yes, it was.
So we don't expect any MSI MOA 2015 live competitions this year?
No.
Okay,
not
so
this year.
Sadly, after 7 years of live competitions and final in Taiwan, this year won't happen. Second question is that the end or the concept will change?
It's the beginning of a new new things.
Yeah, that's why like, I wanted to hear.
I mean, live event, I have no certitude yet. I have no certitude yet because you know already, like it's been 7 years we're doing it, and all others stop it. Besides, like few stuff like the ASUS AOC in Russia, which is organized only by Russia. We don't have much. It's not about the interest because like we care and we support this event for 7 years and support the community for 7 years. But like there is not much sense to do it like we did in the past. Like I think you all of us understand what it means. Like the event, the format we had is very expensive.
It needs a little refresh. Yes.
Yeah, it needs a little refresh. We need to change the way it was done. And the plans for MSI is to at overclocking. So that's what I'm also in charge. And I have some discussion with the management here. And basically, our plan is to be a lot more present online. That's for sure. On HWBot to organize like more online competition. You know that MSI is the most used motherboard brand by user and by result on HWBot globally. So we want to keep going in that way. To push more the extreme overclocking for sure, but to continue to push the rookies with XTU and so on. So to be more present online for sure. We also have the OC Academy, you know, it in UK was well. In France, it has also done well. We want to expand that concept and develop it further, but that's not, MO is not dead for sure. The brand is not dead. We're thinking how to develop it and how to make it more attractive for everyone, not only the overclockers but also MSI. So yeah, basically I have ideas, already discussed with HWBot for next year, and yeah, might be something, but there is nothing sure yet. And for sure the brand, like I said, the brand is not dead. You will see more MOA stuff going on, but live event I'm not sure yet. We are trying to make it better and for everyone, and I hope we will succeed and have something to present next year for overclockers. My goal is really to make it better. Really, it's both for overclockers and MSI, because right now I think overclockers were the only happy guys at the end.
Yeah, but I guess, like you say, maybe connecting this to the OC Academy idea is a good thing. What we notice in the UK, for example, or also probably you in France, there's a lot of new guys coming to those Academy events because they want to learn. And usually MOA doesn't give the chance for people to learn. Like there's very little information on how you can enter or how you can participate. So it was really open to the initiated guys. So it's like... it was really hard for newcomers to start there.
It has always been reserved to the top overclockers. And if we look at the members, purely the members, what are the overclockers, the top overclockers in the top OC community? I mean, it's a really, really, really small part of the OC community. And why we do care about extreme overclockers, and I think we already show it by 7 years of commitment to this event. We also need to think to the rookies, the enthusiasts, all those new leagues, and OC Academy is a good concept to develop that, but yeah, we will not forget about MOA, that's for sure, and I will do my best to have it back, but in a different way. That's something 1,000% sure, not the same way it was before.
Well, yeah, that's
went with Truth to the OC Academy, and that was really, really cool. Like, I really like the fact that you have competitions. It's very similar as well to what we saw at the ROG camp in Germany, or the World Tour for Amateur in France with at the Gamers Assembly. Basically training new guys and straight away get them into a contest. You know, everyone can compete. It's not that hard, even on air or whatever, you know, as long as it's fun. And I guess that's probably one good way to aim at a wider audience as well. Like, because if more people are into it, then more people are going to have interest into it. If it's always the very similar top 25 guys, then, well, there's only interest for the top 25. There's not that much interest for the others because they have nothing to win from it.
Well, actually, there was Dennis, you wrote an article about the overclocking competitions. I think that was like last year, after the like a month and a half after the MOA last year. What was your finding in that article about the like the concept of live competitions where you invite like 18, 20 overclockers? It's just a one shot deal, and what's going on after that? So you had a lot of reflection on that.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, that was something that I noticed. You know, when you guys had me out for the MOA to help cover that event, I noticed that it was, I didn't see much in the way of ROI for MSI. So there wasn't really an incentive for them to keep going the way that they were doing the current competition. I knew what they were kind of after. They wanted to have kind of a grandiose stage where a lot of people were seeing the overclocking and making it into a real esports event. But the article that I wrote was kind of a reflection on how overclocking competitions needed to change. And maybe this is something that everybody at MSI has read or not read, I'm not sure, but it was the concept of it was following more like a pro sports event where you have a certain set of rankings and maybe that's controlled by hardware bots. So then you invite the top 15 competitors to compete in the competition, but you don't necessarily pay to fly them out there. You invite them and then they pay to come out. But then at that point, MSI would be responsible for setting up the event and then making a prize pool that would be worth somebody flying out to compete. So it was just kind of a change in the way that the competition would be organized to make it more interesting for people reporting on the event, more interesting for the people that are at the event, and a bit of a, you know, return on investment for the people hosting the event.
Yeah. It makes me actually think. Go ahead, Pepe.
On top of that, I think some overclockers, top overclockers, which I discuss with, they already know that they were also part of our decision. I mean, you know, Dennis, you have been to the competition, and like you say, there was not so much like it was not attractive for MSI anymore, because like my first MOA final. I didn't compete in MOA finals. I think I win several local events and compete in European finals, but never been to Taiwan yet. And the first time I've been to Taiwan, I was already working for MSI, and it was my first MOA. I was not like involved in the organization. I was just invited there to be with my overclockers friends. And for me, all those top overclockers, they were acting like divas. Really, I had some words with Misha that day, because yeah, that basically everyone was like acting like they deserve everything. I mean, like, because you're doing a hobby, like you deserve to be treated like king. That's not what I think king should be.
So MOA needs to become more challenging, even more.
Oh, I think from my point of view, like, yeah, we need to make a competition more attractive for overclockers, that's for sure. We need to make it more attractive for MSI, but that's something I would like to change in the community, and especially from top authors, is not that they don't deserve anything. Like, they compete, it's the right to compete, but it's just the hobby in the end. It's like just the hobby. Don't take it so seriously. Sometimes
yeah, unless it's your job, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, you know, like, I had guys complain for anything, and you know how Taiwanese people are, they're really kind, and they will not say anything, and yeah, that's something I didn't like at all from the previous MOA and the MOA before, and yeah, that's something, that's not the main problem, actually, that's just something minor, but still, that was annoying to see our fellow overclockers act like they deserve everything, and they deserve to be treated like king when it's not the case. That's something that annoyed me a lot, because like it gives a very bad image of overclockers.
Yeah.
And yeah, you know it. And yeah, let's not get like name calling, but you know, some overclockers had some bad behavior. Yeah, we need to change that, obviously. So
yeah, I think for sure. Well, it's part of making it interesting for others, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I think, yeah, we need to make it more attractive for everyone. And yeah, to make everyone happy, even if it's very, very difficult. But there is some ways, and I think we already have some good direction with the HW Bottle Sea World Tour. So yeah, we need to think about that for the next year, how to organize everything and to make it more attractive for everyone, more benefit for everyone.
Yeah. So if we sum up, MOA is not dead, it's just a new beginning of a new phase. So what I was fearing the most, I didn't want to see another GoSee-like failure happen. So like Gigabyte used to have the GoSee, then they say, oh, we're going to change, and then nothing happened for 5 years from now. So I didn't want to see that, because I've been part of all the MOA, all the one except the 2011 one final. I've been always there since the beginning, and I really like the way that you guys still pushed it and so on. I would always wanted to have this kind of stuff. But as long as it's changing and not dead, so it's not dead, it's just a new reborn, like a phoenix.
For yet about the live event, I cannot promise anything, but for the online, for sure, there will be a lot more. We're going to do a lot more, Q2, Q3. Yeah. You know, we're very close to HWBot, so we are very involved in HWBot, so we are going to launch a lot more stuff for the overclocking guys, for the top and the enthusiasts and the rookies. No one will be forgot. For the live event, I'm thinking to present something for next year, and yeah, if it's approved, then we will have something nice to do.
Yeah. Yeah, it would be cool to see competitions for everybody. That's nice. I like it. That's very important.
Yeah, because, yeah, like I said, the top overclockers, as much as I like them, as much as they are my friends, you cannot count only on top overclockers. And when you look at the numbers, purely looking at the numbers, it's very small. The enthusiast is much bigger. Percentage. The rookies is also bigger. So we need to think about everything. Don't forget the top of the clockers, for sure. They are the incense, the essence of the community. They are driving the rest of the community, and they are showing off, so the others want to do better and want to push further. So we won't ever forget them, but yeah, we still need to think about others. And yeah, OC Academy, I think, is a good concept. HWBot OC World Tour also, when I was in Gamers Assembly in France, I saw the concept is working really well. So why not make a mix of all that and have something nice for next year?
Yeah, sure.
Well, then that would be great. Now I'm excited. Yay!
Yeah. And anyway, you know, like having a different format, that doesn't mean having something less qualitative. I mean, it's not because you spend less money or that it won't be as good for overclockers. It's not because you're doing it the same way or don't keep like have a different format that it will not be fun for overclockers, attractive and benefit for everyone. Like I said, yeah, we need to find a format that satisfies everyone, not only overclockers, because right now that was the case. Only them were happy, and like they didn't even show they were happy. So, what's the point?
They had already won, so you know, just being at the event was their prize.
Yeah. Actually, that's what I was thinking in the past. Like, even for me, when I started, like being flight in Taiwan was a dream. Now you also need to pay 10K of cash, like offer a very expensive hardware and so on, or they won't be satisfied.
Well, I remember that in your article, Dennis, you were saying that if you don't pay for the fly, you just don't pay for very expensive hotel, and you just don't give away all the hardware that you have, but you take all that and you make that in a prize pool. Actually, the prize pool go much, much higher than we could expect. It's like almost a tenfold increase in the prize pool if we take in account all the logistics and all the extra expenses and so on. So yeah, actually it was great. That was the first. You have to remind that MOA was the first long and the longest standing live competitions ever. So far, that will stay for at least six more years, at least. I do expect the World 2 to continue more than 6 years, so.
Yeah.
So,
well, and, you know, and,
that, yeah.
Yeah, the comment that Truth made about changing the prize pool, I did, like, some rough math based off of how many people are at MOA and the hardware that they used and what they gave away for people showing up. And that was like $130,000 US.
It's 25K for flights at least, plus all the hardware, all the CPUs. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, what if you made that $130,000 the price pool? Now all of a sudden it's really attractive for overclockers to do well and fly themselves out to actually be in the competition. So
maybe actually, even find sponsors that sponsor them,
Yeah.
They also spend a lot. Also spend a lot on the qualification. That's a reality. That the qualification has always been expensive for the class A. So, they also expect to be rewarded. Yeah.
Yeah.
Something I can understand, but I see that the format we had needs some improvement in several ways, and was not really. I think there was still a lot of rooms of improvement for that competition, and we will try to see what we can do for that.
There's a lot of things changing, especially in 2015. Like the world tour is changing a little bit how the live event is taken care and dealt with. You guys changed the MWA way of doing it. There is no competition from others for a long time, except for the AOOC in Russia. But that's like that's more like a local event, even if it's for like Europe and Russia. It's not HQ backed, so that's not directly from Taiwan that they made it. So far, there is no live competitions organized by the HQ anymore. That's a statement. Actually, I do think it's sad in a way, but good in a way that there's a new ground up to build up the new the future for the like live competition and live overclocking.
That's also like let's think also about this. There's some budget we can spend to fly more guys into our HQ to have them bench, you know, oscillate more regularly. That's some cash we can spend on the live event. There is many stuff we can do with the cash we were spending on MOA. And anyway, I've organized some others, like even for the HW Bot World Tour. If you compare the cost of both events, you can definitely make something good for less money, and that overclockers will have fun with it.
Okay, there was a question from the live chat from Zizulio, our friend Zizulio. You know him, you already talked with him and so on. It was asking, how do you want overclockers to give back to MSI, not talking about how people behave?
It's not
tricky question.
Yeah, it's not really about giving back to MSI. It's like showing, like, okay, we organize all that event for you. You're happy. You're coming there. Showing some respect and some love. I mean, like, that's the minimum, I think. Like,
yeah, stay polite and
like, yeah, stay polite and show that you're happy to be here. Just not complain all the time. It's like I'm talking personal opinion right now. That's what I saw in MOA, and that's what I told to many friend overclockers. Like, even like, for instance, Michal from not calling any names, but like, he's a good friend, and I've told him before that what happened in last MOA. Like, I told him before many times, and the year before, I remember that like everyone was my colleague. All my colleague was surprised because I had some harsh word for him in the phone, and I told him, like, basically, don't treat me like your girlfriend. that was one issue I had with one overclocker, and it could happen with many other of them. Like, sometimes you just need to be happy with what you got, I think. If I had the chance to be, like, let's say, to be qualified and to win like a ticket to MOA 2013, I'm sure I wouldn't have complained the way they did.
There's a lot of behaving issue, or actually like the what people expect from it. They used to have like an history behind that there was always more and more and more and more, and then someone's like, hey, you have to be rational about all that at some point.
That's also what I think. Actually, that was not, like I said before, that was not the main problem. It was just a minor stuff. But it's also something I would like to change in the community. Like, they realize that overclocking is just a hobby. Even if you compete at the very top level, and spend a lot of money, it's your own choice. Nothing obliged you to be a top of a clocker. So in the end, it's just a hobby, and yeah, you need to do. That's basically, you already understand what I wanted to say. Like,
Well, right. Guys, I think it's time to wrap up the show. It's been an hour and 20 minutes. We're 20 minutes over. We start on time, but we finish late. So, let's one more time, you guys. I think we can close the raffle now. I don't know if there's any. I don't see any people checking for that. Anyway, wrap up of the 2 days' topic. So we did talk a little bit about a lot of different stuff. The first topic was the Edge Robot World Tour Asia. That's going to happen in June, right after the Computex on June 7, 8, and 6, 7, 8. Damn it. So that's that's the first weekend of June for you guys to know. So first weekend of June, that's going to be the Edgebot World Tour. There's going to be a live. There's going to be competitions. There's going to be the ROG OC showdown from ASUS. There's going to be face to face.
There will be a huge amount of stuff to give away on the stream. There T-shirts, some caps.
We already have the
SLI bridges. Some a huge list. Incredible. One then giveaway per 30 minutes, guys.
Then we talk about Computex 2015. We will all be there. Actually, the next OC show will be just before Computex on June 1st.
All live from Taipei.
That's and all cool. Live from Taipei. I'll be there. Timothy, you'll be there. We'll be side by side at the office to make it, or maybe at the show floor. Maybe we don't. Maybe
probably at the office, right?
not on the first. There's no show on the first.
Ah, yeah, true. Maybe at some press conference in the lobby somewhere.
Are you already here, Dennis?
Yeah, actually, I arrived the 30th.
Hey, you're on the show. Welcome.
Hi.
Yeah. We talk about GPU Pi, new CPU and GPU benchmark. You guys can check it out. If you don't know how to use it, you can check youtube.com/overclockingTV and there's an how-to right there. Although we did talk about the HWBot competition points. So what was going on, why they get removed and moved back in. And we had the last debate, the future of OC at MSI, what comes after MOA. And we had Pepino to talk about that, and we highly appreciate to hear and have the confirmation that MOA is not dead, it's just a new reborn, like the Phoenix.
Thank you to have me there.
appreciate that. Was a lot of flaming discussions going on my Facebook after I post this this statement. I do appreciate that you did fix it live and had the time to answer all of the questions.
Thanks.
So Timothy, when is the next OC show?
Well, the next OC show is going to be shot during the next week, so it's gonna air sometimes not this Friday, the one Friday after that. And I'm not too sure what we are going to talk about. So if you guys have any specific topics you would like to discuss, besides, of course, Computex and the more ever-ending rumors we get about unreleased hardware, just feel free to let us know. You know, maybe there's something cool coming up. And yep, that's about it, I guess. Thanks a lot, guys. Thanks, Truth.
Thank you. Thank you, Dennis, for being here. Thank you, Christopher, for being here. We will all see you guys in 2 weeks from now.
Yes.
Thank you. I would like to thank all the guys, although on the live chat, for following us. The last one, Flaming Tiger 419, PA Metal, Pedro Pierre and Paolo PSX2. Thank you guys for being here. Thank you guys, although from Brazil, to tune in. And don't forget, we have a special giveaway going on our Facebook fan page. You can win an ASUS GTX 960 Strix editions, or there's a lot of XXX and XXX. For that, you can just go to facebook.com/overclockingTV, and there is the And It's a Blue Screen contest, where you just record yourself saying "And it's a blue screen" and submit that video to the contest. The contest is open until early June, right?
Yeah.
So that's it for today. Thank you guys for being with us. Thank you guys for watching it online. And we hope to see you in 2 weeks from now from Taiwan. Until then, don't forget, keep pushing it.
Keep pushing it.
Keep pushing it.
Bye.